Thank you for allowing me to talk a little bit on behalf of the IEA Bioenergy Task 32, which I coordinate. IEA Bioenergy Task 32 is basically a collaboration between countries and with an interest in topics related to bioenergy. So the bioenergy agreement covers very different aspects of bioenergy, not only combustion but also, say, other technologies, gasification, pyrolysis, liquefaction, and anaerobic digestion, and so, but also policy matters related to things like greenhouse gas mitigation and social aspects, and so on. So I'm coordinating this this network on combustion and co-firing, which covers everything from stoves to boilers, but also large-scale power generation from biomass and even co-firing biomass with coal. So we are now with 13 countries in the world that collaborate here, exchange experiences, and jointly develop projects also. We had a meeting, for example, on improved stoves last November in Berlin, and some of you were there also. All the reports that we prepare are available for free on the task website. That's enough for task 32. What I will do today is share a little bit of the work that we did in the task for different task members and also organizations involved in our member countries in this topic. So our own organization doesn't have that much budget to carry out fundamental research ourselves, but what we can do is to actually collect and exchange those research results. So what we see around the world is that woodlock combustion, particularly in small scale, is a large source of aerosols. We know that. But on the other hand, we also know that they generate renewable heat, and so we want it, but also we do not want it, you could say. We do not want to have the negative aspects of it. Also, one issue that we are increasingly worried about regarding small-scale biomass is the negative connotation, public perception of small-scale combustion. There are a few people, I think, that burn a stove in a very bad way, and particularly in urban areas, cause a negative image of this renewable energy option. And I think this is also something that we should be worried about. The Renewable Energy Directive and the eco-design will definitely lead to introduction of better stoves across Europe. What was not said today, but what is also important in this regard, I think, is that the Renewable Energy Directive contains an annex, Annex 4, and it says something about the obligation of member states of the European Union to install a certification scheme for installers of renewable energy technologies, and that also includes wood stoves. So, in fact, every member state needs to have some certification scheme for wood stoves also in place. Whether you use it or not, there should be something. And one member state uses that really actively, another one doesn't. So this is quite also an instrument, I think, that can be used to improve the quality of the installations of the wood stoves, which is an important factor in the final emissions. We do want to have a correlation between the emission values on the test bench and the ambient concentrations, but that's also the title of my presentation, but I think I already have to disappoint you in this because it's quite difficult, or if not impossible, to make such a correlation. We were discussing that over the coffee break, but it's the same with cars, probably. We know if you read the brochure for a new car that you want to buy, what the emission values can be on the test bench, but in practice it's always different. It depends on your behavior, it depends on weather conditions, and on many different factors. This is a graph that I show several times, but just to show some variations in particle emissions from different type of small combustion units, varying from pellet boilers to very old wood stoves, and you see, say, a factor of three, say between 10 and over 1,000 milligrams per megajoule. So that's a very wide variation in emissions. So this also implies that it's almost impossible, I think, even if you know exactly the number of appliances in your country, to give a good estimation of the emission from those devices. I don't have the figures for stoves, but this is for boilers. Say some recent figures, biomass boilers. You see that emissions are going down dramatically. This is from type testing in Austria, I think. And this is efficiencies for boilers. Some figures even of over 100% condensing boilers. So we are getting better and better. This is a graph, I think, that was earlier presented by Frank Kiel, HKI. We have many similar figures from other countries also, but you see that there are many older stoves that that are still in place. And for the Netherlands, I was personally involved in some scenario studies, but you see here also how the age of stoves varies over the years. And this was Germany only. So this is in Holland, for example, and we see here, fireplaces are fading out, so the traditional fireplaces. People do not really like that, the operation of it, the consumption of wood is too much, and efficiencies are very low. So we see that though they are there, the use of those devices is also much lower than that of a good stove. So we have here different types of stoves. And we try to model that, say the amount of stoves and also the number of hours that they are being used. We have some emission factors from projects that were carried out by, for example, TNO. TNO tried to characterize typical emission factors for a certain stove in practice, but that's of course very very difficult. You don't know what is the typical emission factor for a certain stove. It's just impossible, I think, to do that. If you calculate overall emissions with such models, you can come down. You can arrive at certain conclusions. For example, in this case, for Holland, we see that the number of devices goes down. That's the first graph, but the use of it increases. So this is the second graph, is the amount of biomass, the quantity of biomass being burned in those devices. And we see that more and more devices, that's the brown part of the graph, become compatible with DIN Plus. We see also that emissions go down. So this is CO, and that's dust, for example, total dust. So it's possible, I think, that was the aim of this scenario study. This is already an old one. I will show some results of a later one after this. But the message of this study was quite clear. You can have more renewable energy with lower PM emissions. So I think I don't really have to tell much about how to design a good stove, but these are some basic rules for designing a good stove. Try to avoid areas in the combustion chamber where you don't have a good circulation. Make it a bit round and avoid large windows. We do want to have something nice in the living room as well, but if you ask a technician to design the stove, you will probably get something completely different than if you ask my wife, for example. And there are some other innovations also which may help. So it's not only the stove itself. You can also think of a bleed air flap at the bottom of the chimney to avoid excessive drought. Maybe just a simple temperature display that shows you the temperature in the flue gas. And also, there are some control units that try to control the temperature of the the amount of combustion air. There are even some very fancy devices. This is from a Danish manufacturer, and they have some very good results also with this. So controlled airflow. The disadvantage of such concepts is, of course, that you still need a plug and a power plug, and that's almost unavoidable nowadays, I think, too. If you go to better stoves, in the end you need to have it connected to the main power also. So basically we can design a very good stove nowadays. It's possible to have a good stove with very low emissions under optimal conditions. But what is the very big elephant in the room, I think, is the user behavior. We don't know what the user is actually doing at home with the stove. Also, I don't know exactly what is what's happening there. This is just just a few slides that I will show from TFZ Straubing. They are involved in the work of our task also. And some time ago, Hans Hartmann presented some interesting results of a study they did, where they compared, say, optimal combustion in a stove with suboptimal combustion, and looked at the PM emissions. So here also they took two evaluations, both for, say, the dilution tunnel and the hot filter. And the first influence they evaluated was on the log size. I think this was also already mentioned today, but if you take very small logs on the left hand side, or a few large logs, both with all of them with almost the same mass, but just different divided over different logs, and you can see here quite clearly, I think, that the red bars are for I have to go to particle emissions, say the diluted the red bars are for the dilution tunnel, and you can see here that I think that it's quite clear here that you have the sort of optimum size for the wood log. So if it's too small, you will see very rapid combustion, and if it's too large, you can the combustion doesn't start quickly enough. So there's some optimal there. The amount of fuel is also not the same. So the fuel charge, you can say, you also see an optimum there. If it's too small, you can see that the combustion goes very quickly, and you need to go for a refill very quickly. If you fill it too large, then you cool down the fuel bed too much. So it's also not optimal. Moisture content, the same picture. There's also an optimum there. So if it's very dry, then you can see also an increase in emission. Also for very wet wood, it's also quite obvious. And you'll see smoldering and also very high emissions. Sorry. Fuel composition, whether it's it contains bark or not, and the shape of the wood logs, and it also has quite a big difference and a big impact, and particularly burning bark is causing quite a lot of emissions. Ignition methods, whether we ignite it from the bottom, traditional method, or from the top. So all those factors are really important, and you see here, say, a factor of how much is it, maybe a factor of four or so. So comparing just the influences of those factors, you see quite big differences, I think, in emissions between optimal and suboptimal. So you can have measured by a dilution tunnel, for example, taking very wet wood, you have 20 times more dust emissions from this particular stove. So reducing emissions, that's the ultimate aim. That, of course, starts with a good stove, but the way of installation, the fuel specifications, and the user behavior are, I think, the big elephants in the room. And it's very hard to get a grip of those factors. How important are they on average? We know from such small studies that they are important, but what would be average assumptions for those? That's difficult to do. Again, I think Annex 4 of the Renewable Energy Directive, I think this is something that that provides a tool for quality improvement. I think in Germany, you're doing a very good job where the chimney sweepers have a lot of power and they can do many things which are impossible to do in my own country, Holland. So enforcement is then also a key in here, I think. User training and awareness is also I think something that still needs quite a lot more attention. And I was in Austria last year and at some biomass conference, and there I got a small matchbox, which you quickly accept, of course. And if you open it, there was a small brochure in it, how to light your stove from the top, and not too wet, and all these basic aspects for good combustion. I think that's something that is quite underestimated. In the end, when we talk about air quality, say we cannot just secure air quality by offering good stoves to the market. It's also about the use of it. So, how to translate test bench results into practice? Well, I think there are only a few reliable stove measurement campaigns performed, like this one in Germany. I think I like that study. That comes up with quite many typical emission figures for different types of stoves. But those types of studies are very time-consuming, and they are expensive, and secondly, you also don't know how representative they really are. What we do in Holland is, as a first assumption, to look at the margin that is obtained in the type testing, so we know that that actual emission at the test bench is somewhat lower always than what is required. Otherwise, you do not meet the limits. So there is some margin there, but given the fact that we see all these differences here, you must have a very, very good stove, I think, if you are able to burn wet wood of a varying particle size and maybe ignite it differently. Then you easily exceed the emissions limits for type testing. But if we are a bit optimistic, then we can say, okay, it's more or less in the same order of magnitude. Just as an overview, I have here some emission figures which we used in the Netherlands, and you can see here, say. For these ones, for example, the inset appliances, the older ones and somewhat newer ones, which are not compliant with NIM+, those figures were derived from actual field measurements. But of course, there's some big variation around this figure. It's just the order of magnitude should be more or less okay, but you are certain that there is a big error in this, but we don't have anything better than that. We know, say, if you take the other regulations like BIM Plus, the BIM Schwau phase 1 and 2, then you have different figures. And there was a German inventory that came up with other figures, and you see, for example, for particles that they are, well, more or less somewhere there. So this is an, it's much worse than the better ones, but also not as as bad as what we had in Holland until recently. So the order of magnitude is more or less okay, you could say. This was a recent study performed in Holland where we not only looked at stoves, but also at boilers, biomass boilers. And you see here, that's why the text is in Dutch, I'm sorry for that. So the stoves are here, the three bottom parts. You can see that's more or less stable. It's the number of the amount of biomass being burned in those appliances. And the real growth is actually with the larger biomass boilers. That are used for district heating projects and so. And what we see here with the emissions in terms of PM10 is that they are going down. Also for the stoves, so the bottom parts, because we see better and better stoves being introduced. For the additional energy generated with the new biomass boilers, the additional emission because of that is not so much compared to the stoves, but as I showed here, the contribution in terms of renewable energy is quite substantial. So finally, there is no single emission factor. You will have an error by assuming any factor. The best would be to carry out some extensive practical measurements, field measurements, but that's really expensive and time-consuming, and it's doubtful whether you get any really meaningful and reliable results out of that. The margin in type testing is certainly filled up by the suboptimal field conditions, and probably you will have higher emissions in practice than what you see at a type testing. But it's more or less of the same order of magnitude, I could say. The margin is smaller for automated devices, where the user is the user influence is taken out of the equation. I know that in Denmark, for example, this is a reason why the Danish government has promoted pellet boilers and stoves, because the user influence is much less there. Yeah, that was it already. Any questions?